There's still a few people coming in, but as we get the room settled, please keep a beautiful silence as we open with the strings of Kol Nidre.
Thank you. Yeshiva Shema Ta.
Sovereign of the universe, in awe and humility, I have come to stand before you to pray with your people Israel and on their behalf. Who is fit for such a task? Yet you are present to us whenever our voices rise in praise. In your great mercy, have compassion on me and on us all. Let my congregation not falter on my account, nor I on theirs. Guide the lips of those who lead your people in worship. Strengthen our faith and purify our thoughts. And let your love draw a veil over all our failings. So may our prayers ascend this day to the throne of your glory. We now call upon the most beautiful woman in the room, Wendy Yedwab, to lead us in the lighting of the candles.
We invite your presence, O God, as we bless the lights of the Day of Atonement. May their radiance illumine our hearts so that we might become at one with you, at one with others, and at one with ourselves. Help us to understand that the true significance of this day is forgiveness, and that only as we forgive others can we hope that you will forgive us. Baruch ata Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam asher kiddushanu b'mitzvotav vitzivanu lahadlik ner shel yom hakippurim. Blessed is Adonai our God, ruler of the universe, who hallows us with mitzvot and commands us to kindle the lights of the Day of Atonement. Baruch ata Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam shehechianu v'kiyamanu v'higianu lazman hazeh. Blessed is Adonai our God, ruler of the universe, for giving us life, for sustaining us, and for enabling us to reach this season.
Upon two past presidents of Temple Israel, Jack Kamaker and Joel Peel, and also the king of Temple Israel, David Tisdale, to come forward. He's also a past president, for the honor of facing the congregation for Kol Nidre, and we ask you to please rise.
Lev
Prepare for Kol Nidre on page 251 as we pray responsively. In the sight of God and of the congregation, no matter how far some of us may have transgressed by departing from our people and our heritage, we pray as one on this night of repentance, Kol Nidre, a whisper of wings, as promises are remembered. Saint and sinner alike communes with the Most High, we are at one.
Thank you.
Nidre, Esarana la Esare.
Knowingly or not, the whole community of Israel and all who live among them have sinned. Let them be forgiven. God said, I have pardoned in response to your plea.
Arukata Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam she'eteyanu ve'kiyemanu ve'higiyanu la'zeman ha.
Continue with the Shema on page 255, and as we do, I would just like to suggest that really this prayer, we call it the watchword of our faith, but this is what this evening, what this religion, what this people is all about: unity, oneness. We are together with the grace of God as we sing together this song of oneness.
Continue together on 255.
Ve'avta et Adonai Elohecha bechol levavcha ubechol nafshecha ubechol meodecha ve'hayu hadvarim ha'ele asher anochi metzavecha hayom Vishinantam levanecha, vidibata bam, vishivtecha bebetecha, vlechtecha vaderech, vishokbecha uvekumecha, ukshatam leot al yadecha, vihayu letotafot ben enecha, uketavetam. Mizot betecha uvisharecha leman tizkeru vasitem et kol mitzvotai item kedoshim lelohechem ani Adonai Elohechem asher hotzeti etchem meyeretz mitzrayim
Redemption is a word that only rabbis use. I mean, think about it. When have you used the word, unless it's about coupons, redeeming coupons? It's just not a word. And yet, if you think about it, it really means freedom, freeing. And so in this Kol Nidre, I would ask you to focus as we sing on page 257, this song of redemption, on how you might free yourself from the shackles that bind you, the shackles of anger, of other people's expectations, of addictions, of recurring negative patterns. Redemption. Let's free ourselves as we sing together.
The shadows fall, but end of day fills the eye with brightness. The infinite heavens glow, and all creation sings its hymn of glory. With hope, therefore, we pray for light within. O God, reveal yourself, hide no more. Let your face shine on all who seek you. Then shall we be at peace, O God, whose peaceful shelter we seek through all the days and nights of our lives.
Together on page 260.
Remember us unto life, O Sovereign who delights in life, and inscribe us in the book of life for your sake, O God of life.
Leman, Mashiach Magen. Baruch atah Adonai, Magen Avraham, Vezra Hatzara.
Is the eternal power at the heart of life, mighty the love that is stronger than death. Life's harsh winds uproot the weak, its hard rains beat down upon our kin. Let those who stand support the falling, keep faith with those who lie in the dust. How good to redeem the ancient pledge, for joy to blossom in arid soil. As you're seated, we offer the words of our heart in silent prayer.
Turn to page 169 and rise for the public confession of sins. 269. See, I'm making mistakes already, so I have plenty to repent for. They forgave me in the front row, so I'm good. Together, our God, God of our mothers and fathers, grant that our prayers may reach you. Do not be deaf to our pleas, for we are not so arrogant and stiff-necked as to say before you, our God and God of all ages, we are perfect and have not sinned. Rather do we confess, we have gone astray.
We have sinned. Ay, 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 try that. Ay, 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 after me. Ashamnu, Ashamnu, Baganu, Gazanu, Dibanu Dofi.
Received an email today from a good friend who happens to be in the room today, I believe, this evening, asking me a rabbinic question. How many times does xenophobia occur in the Jewish liturgy for Yom Kippur? And I had to explain to him that it doesn't occur at all. It's just that the prayer we just prayed, Ashanu, is an acronym which goes from A, from Aleph, all the way to Taf, right, in the Hebrew alphabet. But unfortunately, in English, it's a little bit harder because we have words like, we have letters like X. So what's amazing about this this wonderful acrostic that you're going to be reading in a second is that they came up, the author, Chaim Stern, came up with a sin for X, xenophobia, but somehow couldn't think of anything for H. Hatred, heinousness, you know, undue hilarity, whatever. You know, we could have done better than, but so you can fill in your own H sin when you get to that point in the prayer. We have all committed offenses. Together we confess these human sins. Some of us kept grudges, were lustful, malicious, or narrow-minded. There was violence, weakness of will, and yes, xenophobia. We continue on page 271 with the Al-Chait prayer together. The sin we have committed against you under duress or by choice, the sin we have committed against you consciously or unconsciously, and the sin we have committed against you openly or secretly, the sin we have committed against you in our thoughts, the sin we have committed against you with our words, and the sin we have committed against you by the abuse of power. For all these, O God of mercy, forgive us, pardon us, grant us atonement. The sin we have committed against you by hardening our hearts, the sin we have committed against you by profaning your name, and the sin we have committed against you by disrespect for parents and teachers, the sin we have committed against you by speaking slander, the sin we have committed against you by dishonesty in your work, and the sin we have committed against you by hurting others in any way. For all these, O God of mercy, forgive us.
שחטאנו לפניך בחוזק יד.
על חטא שחטאנו לפניך.
על חטא שחטאנו לפניך בחילול השם.
על חטא שחטאנו לפניך.
That I mentioned the Shema is when God calls us to hear. In this prayer on page 278, we ask God to hear us.
Tashlichenu.
Service, there's God asking us to hear and then us asking God to hear. It's almost like some marriages, you know, back and forth, and no one, not like our marriage, but you know, back and forth with no one actually listening. And we're going to do it again with the Vino Malkeinu coming up in a moment. And so I'm going to ask us to really think for a moment about the prayers that we want God to hear and also the prayers that we want to have heard. So I'm going to ask you, before we pray the Avinu Malkeinu, really take a moment of silence to think about the prayers that you want to hear and those that you want to have heard. We continue with a moment of silence.
We read together on page 280. Avinu Malkeinu, hear our prayer. Avinu Malkeinu, let the gates of heaven be open to our plea. Avinu Malkeinu, let this be an hour of compassion and favor. Avinu Malkeinu, give strength to your people Israel. Avinu Malkeinu, remember those slain for their love of your name. Avinu Malkeinu, remember those who went through fire and water for your sake. Avinu Malkeinu, be mindful of us and help us. Avinu Malkeinu, inscribe us in the book of forgiveness. Avinu Malkeinu, inscribe us for blessing in the book of life. Avinu Malkeinu, inscribe us in the book of deliverance and redemption. Avinu Malkeinu, be gracious and answer us, for we have little merit. Treat us generously and with kindness, and be our help.
Say, Manu, Tedaka Vahes, and Behoshi. How many of you got your boating license when you were 14? I got mine in health class, West Bloomfield High School, 1991. I'm still not 100% sure what it has to do with health class, but I guess when you're a teenager living around the Great Lakes, a boating license is part of a healthy lifestyle. I don't remember doing much to earn the license, and I for sure didn't step on a boat. Must have been some sort of written test. In any case, I was proud to flash the only license I had to date. Merely by turning 15 and having a pulse, I got my pink parents' driving permit 3 days after I turned 15. Though the name was pink parents' permit, my sister proudly let me drive her cherry red Celica on that day. It was totally illegal and totally awesome. Thanks, Reese. Then at 16, I went to the Secretary of State's office. My parents signed something and poof, I had a license to drive. I know I took some kind of class, but I remember nothing. There was no driving test, just practice with my parents. Far less than there is today. Put simply, I could see over the wheel, reach the pedals, barely, and I passed whatever 10 question tests existed in 1993. I had my driver's license. In 2007, Ryan and I got our marriage license, again, a pretty easy process. There should be a class or a test or a waiting period, some kind of license to have children, but there isn't, and that's for another sermon. Today on Yom Kippur, I'd like to talk to you about yet another license. It's called a moral license, and it's probably not what you think it is. I had never heard of a moral license until I listened to Malcolm Gladwell's podcast, Revisionist History. Gladwell might sound familiar from his award-winning book, The Tipping Point. On June 16, 2016, he premiered Revisionist History, and since that day, I cannot get enough. I've even tried to contact him and tell him there's a rabbi in Michigan who has become his number one fan, and I must meet him. I haven't heard back. I forgive him. It's Yom Kippur. I've listened to the episodes many times, but none more than the first, the episode that taught me about moral licensing. Moral licensing is the theory that helps us understand that when we do good, it doesn't always lead to doing more good. You would think that that was the case, but it's not. When we do good things, we give ourselves the moral license not to act morally or justly the next time we have the opportunity. Instead, we pat ourselves on the back for having done good once and give ourselves a free pass the next time. The simplest example is one that I think we have all used at some point of your lives. How many of you have had a fabulous workout, you've pushed hard, you felt good, you burned your breakfast, so obviously you deserve a treat. Good run. Supersized fries. Great spin class on Saturday, hot fudge Sunday. It's a simple example, yes, but it's the easiest to grasp. Gladwell argues that when we perceive we have acted justly or kindly or correctly, we give ourselves moral license the next time a decision of right or wrong comes around to do the opposite of our own expectation and the expectation of those around us. He said we've proven to the world what a good and virtuous person we are, so we get to flash our moral license the next time. Good does not always lead to more good. A more weighty example he offers is what happened in the country of Australia after electing its first, and now only to date, female Prime Minister, Julia Gillard. After 110 years of male leaders, the Australian people could congratulate themselves for electing a woman. But once they did, many within the country and the government itself licensed themselves to display misogyny openly and at toxic levels. So what did Prime Minister Gillard do? She excoriated the men who turned against her on the floor of Parliament, with the biggest offender sitting right in front of her, Tony Abbott. If that name sounds familiar, it's because Tony Abbott would later become, you guessed it, Prime Minister of Australia. Australia is one of 17 countries that have had one and only one female head of state. Gladwell insists we should not be surprised. It's classic moral licensing. The sad truth is that we often give ourselves moral license based on pretty flimsy virtues. And if you think you might be the exception, you're looking to your neighbor and thinking maybe they do that, but I don't. Remember, it's Yom Kippur. It's best to be honest. Speaking of giving people a look, I'm getting a couple right now that says something to the tune of, well, thanks, Rabbi, now what? If you're telling me that doing good won't lead to more good, what's the point? I'm so glad you asked. The point is that Judaism has never left us without an opportunity to change, to do better, and to be better. That is the very essence of what we are doing here today. We are meant to do tshuva. Yes, we often translate tshuva as repentance, but it's so much more than that. Real tshuva happens when you find yourself in the same situation where you acted selfishly or with apathy, and you act generously and with compassion the next time. Tshuva isn't just about saying, I'm sorry. It's about saying, I want to get better. So Mr. Gladwell, with all due respect, on this Yom Kippur, the members of Temple Israel will no longer be renewing their moral licenses. Instead, each individual is issued a mitzvah license with indefinite renewal. If you are wondering how to assure that you will indeed make this switch, that your doing good will lead to more good, I am happy to tell you that your congregation is on a mission to help you make this a reality. This year, we are creating a legion of Tov teams. Tov in Hebrew means good. Tov teams will be teams of good or goodness teams. They will be small groups of people with common interests doing acts of goodness in our little corner of the world and elevating those acts to the sacred. We want you to be part of a Tov team that means something to you so that you can bring holiness into your life and the life of the people that you touch. Look at this picture and listen to these words. They are the reflections of one of our Jewish personal trainers, a Tov team that goes into people's homes and hangs mezuzahs, bringing holiness to every doorway. This Jewish personal trainer wrote to Cantor Smolash, "Good morning, Cantor. I just finished my first mezuzah visit with such a beautiful young family. They were warm and welcoming. They weren't 100% sure what to expect, but neither did I. But it turned out to be a great visit. We hung two mezuzahs, one on each of their young kids' door. I explained the prayers on the scroll and led them in the prayers for hanging the mezuzah. I suggested they pick up their daughter and let her touch the mezuzah to familiarize herself with the feeling of God watching over them. It was an awesome feeling. I can't begin to tell you the rush of joy I felt. Thank you for this program. It's a win-win for everyone." You don't have to be a cantor or rabbi to do sacred acts and help others perform rituals in their homes. You just have to be open to tradition and excited about sharing that tradition with others. If you choose to do that, you too can feel that rush of joy, that feeling of doing something tov, something good for someone else. Meet Florence. Her son has lived in Italy for decades, and her husband and daughter passed away years ago. She is wise and beautiful and funny. She has loving family here in Michigan, but we are still entitled to have friendships, no matter how old we are. Our Bikur Chaverim group is going out into our community and visiting older adults who can't get out that much. Bikur Chaverim simply means visiting friends. You might be familiar with the term Bikur Cholim, that means visiting the sick. Our friends aren't sick, though they might have difficult stints at times. Our friends just can't get out as much. And for many of them, they are the last among their friends, and they miss the fun and warmth that friendship brings. Like the Jewish personal trainers, this group is supported by a member of the clergy, in this case, me. Our volunteers are paired with friends, and they make visits as often as they mutually agree to. So far, this little group has done over 100 visits in a year. They talk baseball, former careers, and of course, grandchildren. Some go out to lunch, some play cards. They have visited their friends at home in rehab facilities wherever they happen to be. They bring little gifts that help their friends celebrate Jewish holidays. They keep in touch with the families, letting them know when they visit, and sometimes they bring up concerns if they see something that isn't quite right. In this picture, Mary Jane and Gail are helping Florence celebrate her 101st birthday. If you don't have a centenarian in your life, you really should. I've been blessed to know many, and I have a few hundred plus people in my life right now. They are living history and by far the coolest people I know. The Jewish personal trainers in Bikur Chaverim are lay-led, just like our Shiva minions. It's not the rabbis and cantors making these acts of tov, of goodness, happen. It's you. And this rabbi is greedy. I'll say it right here on the bima. I am greedy. I want more. I want more goodness, done by you, supported by us. I have dreams of creating a tov tutor team. Are you a teacher that has 1 or 2 hours a week to donate to an anxious teen? You can come to rabbis for help with lots of things. Math is not one of them. Are you a baker? Anyone who has had a delicious homemade treat knows that can be a religious experience. We need volunteers to come to our morning minyan. To be part of this Tov team, you need not be a professional davener. You just have to be willing to sing off key and offer a smile. You get the point. On the holiest day of the year, I'm asking you to lead this congregation. A colleague recently wrote that oftentimes it's a teach us rabbi model, but he argues, and I agree, that the model should be let's teach each other. I hope that right now you're wondering what you could do, which group you would lead or participate in. I hope you don't leave this today and say, well, it was a nice sermon. I mean, I hope you leave and say it was a nice sermon. But I admit it, I'm a greedy rabbi. I want you to weigh thinking to yourself, I want that rush of joy. I want to do some good, and then more good, and then maybe a little more. And I'm going to call Rabbi Jen after the holiday and get started. That's how the other two groups started. Someone called us. Our challenge on Yom Kippur is great. We're challenged to repent and do tshuva in the coming year. I'm sorry, not sorry, that I'm adding one more challenge. I challenge you to a life of doing tov, of doing good. And in doing so, trade your moral license for a mitzvah license. Can you imagine coming to Temple Israel 1 year from now and standing up and saying, I fell short, not by doing things that were maybe necessarily bad, but by not doing even more of what is good? May we all find ourselves with these words in our mouths 1 year from today.
It's up to us to call ourselves to task, to sing what's good and true, to bring about redemption is what we were free to do. For what's the point of being here if we're not moved to change our ways? Aleinu l'shabeach, it's time to live our praise. Carrying the stories of the one. stories will be told of us when we are here no more. We commit ourselves to action. It brings meaning to our days. Alleluia, Bea. It's time to live our praise. It's up to us.
Thinking about what Tov team I can be a part of, and I'm looking forward to hearing from Rabbi Kaluzny about all the calls she gets next week as we strive to bring more good into our community. We turn now to the conclusion of our service as we rise for the adoration on page 282. Announcements before we turn to the end of our service. Tomorrow, you are welcome to come back in this room, but we invite you to switch rooms so you can hear Rabbi Bennett's sermon. We have services and study sessions all day long tomorrow, so if you would like to stay throughout the day, please park across the street at Shenandoah. There'll be golf carts shuttling you across so that you don't block anyone else in our parking lot. And as I said, there are study sessions at 11:30, at 1:30. We have mincha moments in the afternoon and concluding services, Yizkor and Ne'ilah, following that. Bring back your canned goods for Yad Ezra. If you haven't done that, we invite you to bring those back tomorrow as well. Continue on page 280. Birth is a beginning and death a destination, and life is a journey. From childhood to maturity and youth to age, from innocence to awareness and ignorance to knowing, from foolishness to discretion, and then perhaps to wisdom, from weakness to strength, or strength to weakness, and often back again, from health to sickness, and back we pray health again, from offense to forgiveness, from loneliness to love, from joy to gratitude, from pain to compassion, and grief to understanding, from fear to faith, from defeat to defeat to defeat, until looking backward or ahead, we see that victory lies not at some high place along the way, but in having made the journey stage by stage, a sacred pilgrimage. Birth is a beginning and death a destination, and life is a journey, a sacred pilgrimage to life everlasting. Think about those whom we've loved and lost who are not here with us on this Yom Kippur as we rise to recite the Mourner's Kaddish on page 284. Yitkadal v'yitkadash mei rabah, ve'alma divra chirute v'yamlich malchute, v'chayechon uv'yomechon uv'chaye d'chol beit Yisrael, v'agala uv'izman kari v'imru amen. Yehesh mei rabah mevorach le'olam omeo amaya, yitbarach v'yishtabach v'yitpa'ar v'yitroman v'yitnase, Vita dar, vita le, vita lal, shmeid kudasha brichu, leela minkol, birchata vashirata, tushbechata venechamata, dami ram bealma vimru amen. Yehesh lama rabba min shemaya, vim alenu beal kol Yisrael, vimru amen. Ose shalom vimromav, huya se shalom, alenu beal kol Yisrael, Bimru, amen. May the source of peace and peace to all who mourn and comfort to all who are bereaved among us.
We conclude our service at the bottom of 284 with Ose Shalom. Matovar.